Dr. Ruzenza Bajesy was appointed director of CITRIS and professor of electrical engineering and computer science department at UC Berkeley in 2001. From 1998 to 2001, she was assistant director of the computer information science and engineering of National Science Foundation, where she managed over $500 million annual budget. From 1972 to 98, she was a professor of computer science and engineering at University of Pennsylvania, where she was also the director of University of Pennsylvania's General Robotics and Active Sensory Perception Lab, which she founded in 1978. By the way, I know her, in fact, from when I was at University of Pennsylvania. In fact, I was not directly her student, but a close friend of mine was, in fact, doing his PhD under her supervision.
Your age when your students get retired.
And look now, I mean, I am right now almost retired, but then she's still working. I'm still achieving. That's really good.
You were.
Really, that's you. Yeah.
You were and not my student, so
I yeah, but I mean, parallel, we basically.
Right.
Okay. Dr. Bajesy is a pioneering researcher in machine perception, robotics, and artificial intelligence, and has done seminal research in the areas of human-centered computer control, cognitive science, robotics, computerized radiological and medical image processing, and artificial vision. She is highly regarded not only for her significant research contributions, but also for her leadership in the creation of a world-class robotics lab recognized worldwide as a premier research center. She is a member of the National Academy of Engineering as well as the Institute of Medicine. She is a recipient of Franklin Medal 2009 Award and especially known for her wide-ranging board outlook in the field of her cross-disciplinary talent and leadership in successfully bridging such diverse areas as robotics and artificial intelligence, engineering, and cognitive science. Dr. Bajesy received her Master of Science and PhD degrees in electrical engineering from Slovak Technical University in 1957 and 67, respectively. She also received her PhD degree in computer science from Stanford University in 1972. So it's my pleasure to introduce Dr. Bajesy.
Thank you very much.
You know, folks, if you live long enough, you know, you do a lot of things. And, I mean, that's what my bio is saying. It's my pleasure to be here, and I must say this is my first time, and I'm really impressed how beautiful your campus is. It's really manicured and nice green and a lot of space. I mean, in Berkeley, of course, many of you know Berkeley is sort of crowded. And I was asked to tell you what is CITRIS. So CITRIS started, I was the founding director, and so that started in 2001 when I came to Berkeley. And it stands for Center in Information Technology Research in Interest of Society. And actually, I retired from Penn after almost 7 years, and I accepted this job because I said, well, I built robots for the last 30 years and machines, and it's about time to be able to do something that will serve society. So when I came to Berkeley, I kind of looked around a little bit, and I said, well, I'm an engineer anyway. I mean, I cannot deny them, and that's what I know how to do, and that's what I do. But let's ask, what can computer engineering help in improving the societal lives that we live in? And I came to conclusion that the biggest contribution that information technology can do is facilitating communication, improving communication. And if you think about it, it's really revolutionized how we interact, the email, the social networks, and you know, it really, you know, my husband always, you know, who is a physicist and who complains about information technology because it's not physics, right? you know, he says, well, it's sort of puts too much information. Google, you know, you type in on Google and you find anything and everything. You know, it's encyclopedia on your fingertips. And you really, you know what happened 5 minutes ago in India or in China, and so we really are connected much, much closer and much more intimately. Now, is it good or bad? Yeah. And I replied to my husband, who comes from this atomic era, that the same way as high energy physics can be used for better improvement of energy. We have nuclear energy as a resource that does not really pollute, right? But the same way, the A-bomb finished the Second World War earlier than otherwise, but at the same time killed how many hundreds of thousands of lives. And so, every technology can be used and abused. So the same way, information technology. So I kind of, last 10 years, dedicated my efforts to ask myself, how can the information technology help to communicate better? And in particular, when Mr. Bush went to Iraq and without any understanding of all these different cultures, I felt that perhaps information technology can help in bringing us closer together and helping us to understand each other better. And because I believe that we communicate not only through language, but also through our body, I decided to focus my efforts in designing a laboratory and an infrastructure that facilitates you to see yourself, be there, interact with other people. And my hope is, and look, I have been doing it almost 10 years and I'm not yet there, but I will show you where I am, that this technology can help bring people closer together and learn about each other's culture and therefore hopefully remove some more possibilities for wars, although, you know, it's only hope. And I hope that this technology will help to that. So, with this introduction, let me just get on with my talk. And I was sort of warned that the talk should not be too technical, and that it should be more intuitively broad, accessible to a broader audience. So that's what I will try to do. So although there will be some technical things, but don't worry, I will try to explain it as best as I can. Okay. So this kind of work is you cannot do it by yourself. So I have all these collaborators with UC Davis, University of Illinois, Merced, Vanderbilt, and so forth. So, and of course, you need money. I mean, what can you do without money, right? So, okay. So, this is the overview, and I will. How much time do I have, please?
Like 3/4 now.
3/4. Okay, 45 minutes. Fine. So I will talk about some of our accomplishments and then the difficulties of building or challenges building infrastructure. Applications, I will talk about quite a bit about applications, and if time permits, I will talk about also we have another technology where we have wireless accelerometers we can put on the body and again observe movement of people. My whole focus is on understanding human motion as a language, as what do you communicate with that. So I actually have these two different technologies. These are the goals. Okay, so what is teleimmersion? Teleimmersion is a computerized infrastructure where you put one person in one place, geographically distributed. So the woman on the left is in Illinois, and the two women on the right are in Berkeley, and we, with our computer vision technologies, we digitize them and put them into a common virtual environment. That's what teleimmersion is. And of course, what you really want is that you want also have a multimedia, not only vision, although my expertise is in vision, so I focused on vision, but now I have some people who are also looking at the sound, so how to bring through the net, through your internet, into a common space. So this is the system's overview. So you see the button on the left side is really the hardware kind of representation. So you have a bunch of cameras, and I built a laboratory which has 48 cameras in a kind of 360 degree surround. Okay, and the 48 comes about because I have 12 clusters of these four cameras, okay, that you have on the top. And the four cameras are, three cameras are black and white for reconstructing the stereo. You understand that if you have just one camera, you lose the three dimension, the third dimension, because it's a projection, okay? You get X, Y, but the Z is gone. And in order to recover the Z, you either need to have a motion parallax, or you need two cameras, okay? And then you try to find correspondence, assuming that the point in the space projects simultaneously in the two cameras, and if you can find the correspondence from that, you can reconstruct the Z. So that's the principle, and the third camera on the top is a color camera, which projects texture. Now our newest version, hopefully will be done in summer, we'll have only two cameras because we bought two color cameras which allow us to do the stereo as well. Alright, so that's the camera system. Now each cluster is connected to one processor, alright, and that's all that reconstruction. And then we are connected through a 1 gigabit. Oh, thank you very much. That's very kind of you. Yeah, good. We connect these cameras through a 1 gigabit Ethernet network. Okay. Oh, by the way, these cameras are from Point Grey, and they have that special value that they have electronic synchronization. So they, all of them capture the images synchronously at the same time. Otherwise, you could do it software, but I don't recommend some pain in the neck. Anyway, so we get this 3D, and then of course you have a problem of how you are stitching together these different views, right? Because one cluster looks at it this way, the other, and so forth. So you need, and those are really rotation and translation transformation, so you need to do some calibration. And we have some nice result on that. Okay, so that sort of is the overall, and then from the three-dimensional, cluster of points, that basically represents all your surface points, the geometry, plus time, over time, gets sent to a renderer to display, okay, or it can send to a geographically distributed site where you can look at it, or you can add your own data, and you will see all of that. All right, now the big problem we had, ladies and gentlemen, was how do you do real time? Real time is a killer. And we struggled with this because everybody told us, oh, stereo is a solved problem. Why are you bothering? It's published, it's solved problem. Yes, it is published, but it's not real time. And you have a lot of results in journal publications, but they are not real time. They take offline, takes minutes and so forth. So I was lucky, had some very good, clever student who designed this this kind of partitioning. Basically, you look for homogeneous areas and you tessellate the image based on homogeneity criteria. So if, let's say, I would have a very smooth white shirt, this whole area would be one triangle. On the other hand, on edges, because it's discontinuity, you would get small triangles, okay? So it sensitively tessellate the image, and thereby it reduces the number of points that you need to match. So it's in some kind of a compression scheme that allows you to do, and at the same time we have been able to do, so we went from 4 frames per second, we are now able to do 24 frames per second in reconstruction. So, it's 320 times 240, I mean, it's granted it's not your full scale, but still we are able, but with accuracy comparable with all these offline experiments, so I was very pleased with that. Okay. So what we have is the cameras must be geometrically calibrated, both internal and external parameters. Don't worry if you don't know what the internal parameters are, focal length, think about it that way, okay? There are a few other things like the size of the pixels and stuff like that, but it's really focal length. External parameters is the position of the camera and orientation, okay? It's rotation length, and it's really a linear transformations by rotation and translation. For geographical connectivity, the assumption is that both labs have the visual capturing capabilities. Next step is to combine the two or more sites into a coherent virtual world. Okay, so all sites have the common three, the dimensional joint integrated world, and then by simple graphical manipulation of rendering, each site can view the joint world. The bottom line is calibration. Yeah. Okay, so this really shows you the issue of calibration. So here you have your camera system. This is your here are your cameras. Here are your each camera has an X, Y, Z coordinate system, and that's what you really need. And then you are projecting it into this image space. Okay, with this. And this is your calibration rig. So in the lab you have to calibrate with respect to the scale and with respect to the depths. But then, in addition to that, you also need to calibrate when you put two virtual men together into the same world, because otherwise you would look very differently in Illinois than you would look in Berkeley, you see? So you have to sort of calibrate people. Now, the other one calibration that we haven't solved yet is photometry, that your green shirt looks the same in Berkeley as in Illinois. you know, depending on the different illumination and so forth and so on. So that part, my guys are right now working on that, so that we have. So main challenges in the system calibration, real-time reconstruction, color visualization. Okay. And you can see how much we are worrying about the time, how much it takes the triangulation, which I told you, disparity computation, and then post-processing. So real-time is a big challenge for us. And I will not talk too much about this. So the desired properties of representation, easy manipulation, compression, we want the data to be as small as possible, but these are laws. Wavelet present a good alternative. Some of you may know about wavelet representation, right? And ultimately, we want to render our representation in CD space. Okay, so these are the desiderata of this technology. So this is how we do the tessellation. This is how we do the tessellation. And here are some results where, you know, this is your original picture. This is your tessellated, and you can see where you have more homogeneous regions, you have more dark, okay, you have bigger these triangles. And subsequently, when you reconstruct, you know, from the two stereo views, you lose some information. I mean, there is no free lunch in this world, because you can see that this looks more flat than perhaps it should be, because you were matching only the triangles, and then the triangle is planar, so it will give you this. So anyway, this just shows you the consequences of this. Okay, so this is another slide of this representation disparity, but again, first we take the image of the person, and we do what they call background subtraction. Okay, so we throw away the background, and so that's already a data reduction. Okay, so we do our manipulation on this region, then we do this triangulation, and then we do the matching. As you can see here, we have some missing points, dark. Okay, and then we do some smoothing. So triangulation, and then we measure how long it takes, because as I said, real time is a big issue for us. Okay, so by considering the processing, communication, and visualization aspects of our system, at hand we choose an appropriate triangular wavelet-based representation, and it's shown to decrease the number of operations, and that is really compression gains from using the representation. So, okay. Well, maybe I should say that this part has reduced the amount of bytes that you have to send, especially when you are sending through the internet. You know, it's really significant. So this is very important. So, but this is still, remember, per cluster. So then the next thing is stitching. You know, how do you stitch this whole thing? And this is just showing you that you have one view and another view in these different colors, and how you put them together through this rotation and translation transformation. Now, as you can see, there are certain problems there, as you see on those borders, okay? And that is smoothed out by the graphics. That is smoothed out. That's what's called blending. In graphics, you have blending, so we do that in a better blending. But again, this was my students compared, you know, these different reconstruction algorithms and how long they take, and pick one pixel error, what it comes, and then, you know, while for these it takes 20 seconds, 100 seconds, 14 seconds, and for us 42 milliseconds. So we are really in millisecond area, and yet the error is not there. We have one open problem in this business is occlusion, because at the occlusion you get an edge, but you really don't know what's behind there. And to detecting occluding contours is important, because then you want to look from that camera, which is, I mean, if I have a camera this way and I find that this is an occluding edge, I want to use the camera this way so that I can resolve the ambiguity. So we had a student to do this. So, okay. This relates to, given all the available data, there are several ways of considering the representation of human body motion. Skeleton is the very natural way that one wants to reduce the data to skeleton so that you can do some of the stuff that the robotics community, angles of joints and the velocity and the transformation over time, pose to pose. Okay, so this is the slide I was looking for. This is the compression that our size of packets, you see, which is very important. The regular triangulation will give you, you know, with respect to 30 frames, will give you 45 kilobytes, while we are cutting it down to 15. So it's considerable, considerable reduction.
Now, can I ask you a question?
Go ahead, sure.
Now, what sort of bandwidth are you talking about? Because when you're talking now remote, and sending like 3D stuff, mm-hmm. it's going to be already, although I understand that it seems you're just doing the differences, but still, it's going to be a huge amount of things when you are putting so many cameras.
Actually, because we focus only on the human, okay, and we do this kind of computation, turns out that today I was visited by Dr. Harris from UC Davis, who is they got big money to install broadband network for healthcare applications. And he was asking us exactly the same question. And it turns out that with all this compression that we have in our hands, it's about 100 megabytes. So we are not reaching even the gigabyte.
Right.
And as you know, with the broadband, the gigabit switches from Cisco are now quite accessible financially. I mean, they have 10 gigabit switches, but they are very expensive. But 1 gigabit switches
The thing is that, I mean, right now here, in the departments, we can have the fast Ethernet 100 megabits per second, but then as soon as you go beyond that, remotely, it's going to be very tough, unless you have really, private lines or whatever.
Well, you must be, as a state university, you must be part of the CINIC mm-hmm. network, right? And look, the biggest bottleneck, I mean, the big backbone has I don't know how many lambdas, but there is plenty of bandwidth. The big bottleneck is going from your lab to the edge of the campus.
Right.
At least in Berkeley, this is the biggest problem. Because the edge of the campus to the backbone is reasonably good. It's several gigabits of the bandwidth, but it is expensive to go from your lab to that edge, and I had to really fight with that quite
severely. Yeah,
and I don't know what your edge of your campus, where do you connect to the to the big backbone, but if that connectivity is good, then the big expense is really, you know, what they call the last mile. I mean, that's your last mile, and that's that's your last night.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. So then the rendering should be taking care of, you know, all the putting it and smoothing it. And as I said, in the rendering, it is the issue to recognize, you know, the best reconstruction you get from that camera, which roughly is perpendicular to your surface normal. I mean, is looking perpendicularly on your surface. Okay, so the surface normal is piercing your camera system, and that's what's shown here. Okay, so as you are putting it together, you want to find that camera which, you see, this guy sees this, but this one will be kind of looking at more tangentially and therefore with more error. So you want to take this view and give it more preference to that in order to get, because this guy sees this surface much better. So that is really the rendering issue. And again, how do you do that in real time? So this is a collaboration with UC Davis, and it's not completed yet. It's still a work in progress. We know what needs to be done, but it's still a work in progress. So this is the skeletonization that I had a postdoc that did that, and that's the idea. You really want to reduce. So the question is that if you get this skeletonization in real time, can you just send, let's say, every 10th frame the full data, and in between just the motion data? That's really the question. And that's what you want to do with the skeletonization. We haven't tested it yet, so I'm just alluding to this, that that's really the hope. Okay, so I have now these applications, and I will show you several of these applications. So, you know, folks, there is an interesting sociology behind this, who wants to use it and who is willing to use this technology for this communication. So, what I have encountered for last 2 years is that the artists are the most open-minded people and willing to experiment, you know? And of course, I was lucky I got connected with a woman from the dance department at Berkeley. But, you know, they really look at this as a tool for exploring some artistic ideas. So I will show you some of the videos from early days, but it's really astonishing to me that the most conservative are the physical scientists, you know?
Exactly.
I mean, I went to geophysics people, and you will see some of the stuff that we did with them. They have three-dimensional data. It's clear that it will be useful for them if they could manipulate the data and remotely discuss it. But they tell me, for all these years we were publishing these histograms, so why do we need anything else? It boggles your mind. So, anyway, so the next who are willing to explore this are the archaeologists. Again, not your physical scientists, but the archaeologists, because, you see, number one, with the archaeologists, when they dig, they destroy their experiments, so to speak, okay? So they came to understand that, so as they dig, they take images, slice by slice. So they have digital data like tomography, and then they reconstruct, all right? So, but then the big question for archaeologists that they cannot agree on the interpretation, what this really means, because they really want to reconstruct what happened 2,000 years ago. So they see this technology as a way to bringing them together and hash it out, fight it out, you know, what this really means. And of course, this technology allows you to ask what-if questions. So let me just start with some historical videos, which are not as pretty, but anyway, you will see what I have. So the first thing I show you, what do I show you? Okay. Yeah, this one. So this was 2 or 3 years ago. This is Professor Lisa Weimore, and we had a lot of holes and a lot of flying pixels. Our technology was still developing. This is a woman from Illinois, and they danced together. So
basically, if you want, you can go always to the back and so on,
right.
See the back and so on.
Right. Because, you know, you create this 3D of one woman and another woman and you put them into the same box, basically, and then you can look at them from any angle you wish to. Now, I have to tell you folks, they practice, because you really have to practice, because in reality, there is nobody there. So we call it virtual touch.
But then, it is, I mean, that would be part of the rendering to combine these two.
That's
they don't
right.
necessarily. Yeah.
That's right. No, well, actually, she has to do this,
yes.
But frame by frame, you know, the other person has to be there and the renderer is putting it together. That's correct.
Now, I have a question for you.
Yes.
What's the real use of this? I mean,
just.
In film industry, I think, yes, maybe several years later, I think the film industry will come after you, because this way there they can really
bring
people.
All right, so artistically,
they
find it fascinating. They wrote a paper on the subject. What does it mean to be present?
Yes.
Okay, that's really what they are looking at. And they are examining, you know, this appearing and disappearing, and what does it mean to be physically present as opposed to virtually present. That I grant you that this is more philosophical, but look, on the other hand, think about the following. As we live in this globalized world, maybe it's important to understand what can we learn about each other being in this environment before you meet in the physical environment? You know, and in education, how can you use this to enhance kindness as opposed to punching each other. Go ahead.
So you guys did this all in real time then?
Yes, yes. Okay. 4 frames per second.
Okay.
This was, yeah, and I will show you another one which was, which then, yeah, then showed. The interesting thing was that at one point we had this symposium and I was very apologetic that it's slow and it has holes and there's pixels floating around. And the artists were saying, Dr. Baiji, don't change anything. It's beautiful.
I forget which one now was in Berkeley, which one was in Illinois?
The woman in pink is Berkeley and woman in blue is in Illinois.
Now, would it matter now which location will give you a sharper image?
I have this video which I will show you.
Thousands of physical miles apart, two bodies move, interact, and partner each other in the virtual 3D world of telemersion. The telemersive environment is built collaboratively between the research teams at University of California, Berkeley, and the University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. TV, tele-immersive environments for everybody, allows two geographically distant bodies to inhabit a shared virtual room with digital options that allow multiple vantage points, real-time rendering, and attachment-free movement for the user. TV has given way to a unique interdisciplinary collaboration between computer scientists and dance choreographers. The technical parameters of telemersion are driven by the creative needs and choreographic ideas in dance. Telemersion offers new options with real-time virtual interaction, which promise to change the future of communication and collaboration across distance, culture, and discipline. Potential applications
all kinds of
span the fields of art, medicine, business, and entertainment. From the user's point of view, she enters the environment. Her 3D model is captured by an array of cameras and rendered into a virtual 3D space on multiple displays in real time. Meanwhile, the dancers at the remote site are also captured and rendered in the same way. The 3D streams from each site are then exchanged through high bandwidth network so that dancers at two remote sites can interact with each other virtually in the 3D space. Behind the scene is a highly sophisticated system consisting of 3 main components: capturing, streaming, and rendering, which work together in high synchronization and coordination in real time to enable the virtual collaboration. In the capturing component, multiple 3D cameras are employed to capture the 3D representation of the dancers from a wide field of view. The capturing process does not require the dancers to wear head markers or head-mounted devices, which gives them complete freedom in movement. 10 to 12 3D camera clusters are mounted around the room in 2 rows of different heights, with a wide field of view, so the upper and lower body of the dancer can be fully covered. Each 3D camera cluster is a unit of 4 2D cameras, with 1 color camera and 3 black and white cameras connected to an edge computer. The edge computer performs an image-based trinocular stereo algorithm to compute the depth information of the captured object. All cameras are synchronized by hardware triggers to take shots at the same instant in time. The 3D frames of all cameras have the same timestamp, which consists of 1 3D macro frame. Once the macro frame is ready, it is forwarded to the service gateways for compression and streaming. The content dissemination in a 3D telemersive environment is complicated by its multi-party and multi-stream feature. To address that, service gateways are introduced for each telemersive environment. The service gateways manage local 3D cameras and displays. They also connect with each other to form an overlay network for session management and streaming control of audio and video content over the internet. One important aspect of Service Gateway is to perform semantic-aware content adaptation and multicast management to accommodate the high data rate of telemersive application. The Service Gateways differentiate streams according to the user's viewpoint and coordinate their multicasting to make the most efficient use of computing and networking resources. We apply the voice over IP protocol for the audio channel. The purpose is mainly to let people in the environment easily communicate with each other for the collaboration. The voice is picked up by wireless headset to reduce the echoing effect. In addition, we prepare soundtracks at each site and synchronize the playback of the music during the dance experiment.
The grabbing of each other is tough to imagine. It's very tough to. Yeah.
How much time do you have?
Yeah, but and another 10 minutes.
Okay.
That's good, yeah.
The multi-display rendering system allows the user to watch from different viewpoints simultaneously. Several plasma displays are employed to show the 3D video in large sizes. With accurate calibration, the 3D rendering system allows the user to select her preferred viewpoint in a seamless fashion. The rendering system is also capable of loading pre-scanned virtual environments to create a number of performance spaces, such as the interior of an ancient Roman church, as seen here. The technical accomplishments of the curve system include improved background subtraction and noise reduction, novel 3D reconstruction algorithms, direct human-computer interactions, tele-immersive applications development in the fields of art, medicine, business, gaming, and entertainment, geometric and photometric camera calibrations, and communication protocols. We are working to develop new courses that utilize the tele-immersive environment to teach creativity and dance.
Okay, so let me show you a little bit, you know, some from those. Okay, here we go.
I bet the film industry should be interested in this very much. I mean, for example, the Avatar.
They really want to see polished products. Let me show you what we did with the course that I did. So you can pre-record yourself, and then you can dance with yourself. So this is what this young man did with himself. Okay, and they had a lot of fun. So you can see. So this was their final project. You know? So that's one thing you can do. I mean, you can, you know, use this system. Okay. I had another student, Amanda, who did, you can flip yourself. Okay? I mean, you know, she's upside down. You can shrink yourself. I mean, you can expand yourself. I mean, you know, this is computer graphics. You see, so once you have the 3D information, you can do all kinds of things. And these students were very creative. I mean, you know, you just give them an instrument and they go wild. So,
yep.
So I just wanted to show you that. You know, there are a lot of educational possibilities. And so finally, I wanted to show you the archaeology. So this is a three-dimensional thing from Chinese cave. And you can put all kinds of different objects there. And this is Dr. Kurilo, who has designed some of this. And we are now trying to set up a similar system at UC Merced with the professor of archaeology that wants to create this network of archaeologists And you can manipulate these objects and you can argue about their, okay, users can free move in the 3D objects, and you can also move the objects. Now, this is also very relevant in, we are collaborating with a company, Airbus, who has a global offices all over, and they are interested to bring people when they are designing the airplanes. So, same technology, basically. You can digitize the parts and then have people all over collaborate how to put them together and what needs to be changed and so forth. So that's that. So that's the archaeology. You see that users are exploring the environment in first person about seeing the location. So you can, you know, it's a combination. Once you have the three-dimensional data, it's really computer graphics. So you can do a lot of that. And finally, I will show you, this was, we designed a portable tele-immersion system with few cameras that you can put anywhere. And so we set it up in one of those big halls.
These two are different places?
These are engineers. And then you will see the two dancers are on separate places. And here is sponsor Weimar, and they see each other only on that screen.
That's come true. And when you look
and
at
this
me,
has the improved
with those
reconstruction.
Stars in your eyes, I could walk across Texas with you.
That's the 24 frames.
What? This
that's
is
the
walls across Texas with you in my arms.
Our system likes the skin, the photometric
Texas
problems
with you.
And the rendering is not perfect. You will see those spikes.
I'm lost in your charm, and I could waltz across Texas with you. All 39.
See, that's what they are really interested in. What is physical, what is virtual. That's the reconstructed image, and on the side is the video. So you can see the difference.
With you in my arms, waltz across Texas with you. Like a storybook ending, I'm lost.
So because it's sort of like real time, then you can, they can also do some adjustment correction on themselves if they wanted to. Yeah. I was thinking that, for example, in film industry, you can fight animals very bad, I mean, lions in virtually. I mean, and then make good film to watch, right?
Yeah. So, as I said, the applications are many. And we have done. I'm not sure I can show this Tai Chi. Oh no, it doesn't work. I really should fix this. But in any case, we have done some work with the teacher Tai Chi, showing exercise, pre-recorded, and then showed the bunch of students from Stanford actually. And measured how long it took them to learn the Tai Chi when they could see the rotation as opposed to just video. And we have shown that the 3D has an effect on learning. So that was rather pleasing result. So let me just conclude. So I showed you I told you a little bit about the Tai Chi. I showed you the portable teleimmersion. I showed you the virtual archaeology. And the only thing I can say is that often, you know, why one is asked, why bother? What is this? What is the motivation? So fundamentally, there are two applications: service to the world. We have shown some examples. But then I'm also a professor who is responsible to help students to find PhD topics. So the scientific challenge, find the right representation for human actions when humans are acting but not interacting in the world. So if you are just, alone, moving along, that's one way to do some studies. Implies action segmentation and classification and recognition. And we have some results on that, namely, how can you recognize from difference between bending and twisting and waving and walking and running. So that's the kind of... But more interestingly, what I am really interested in is modeling human and physical environment interaction. Namely, can we model in a systematic fashion two people interaction, physical, holding hands and walking, and or even embracing or pushing somebody. What kind of models? And I have a student who is looking at that with some hybrid nonlinear dynamical systems, and it's very complicated because it leads to a non-convex optimization, and it certainly are nonlinear dynamical systems. So all the standard technologies that are out there do not apply or need to be expanded, and that's what he's looking at. So I'm hoping that in a year or so we will have something to show on that front. So I have another technology body sensor, but anyway. So the scientific challenge is, first and foremost, this technology enables geographically distributed people to interact and communicate, is if they would be in the same physical space. This is the case for teleimmersion. For the body sensor is the same, except we do not create a common space. All our applications call for solving the privacy issue. That's a big deal with this technology. The first thing people look at, the teleimmersion, are you going to use it for sex, the interaction, which again is dynamically changing depending on context.
Without touching at all.
Without touching at all, right. Okay, so application teaching and training, where you wish to teach either by example, Tai Chi or dance, or by demonstration of some physical phenomenon, like physics, chemistry, or biology classes. Arts, where distributed artists can explore different choreographies and training. And then finally, as I said, recognition of human activities. My preference is for better understanding, but of course, unfortunately, the funding is much less there than for surveillance. So, anyway, having said all of that, thank you very much for your attention. And,